legends of comics. Al Jaffee and I met once before on the stage at San Diego, where he gave me my Eisner Award 2 years ago for the Fletcher Hanks book, and I was thrilled then and I'm thrilled now. I got involved in Facebook in the last couple of weeks, and I asked all my Facebook friends, what questions should I ask these two fellows? And several people suggested that I ask Al Jaffee a certain question. Many of these people are fans of Al Jaffee's, and they have read over the years his series snappy answers to stupid questions. So they suggested the first question that I ask Al Jaffee is, are you Al Jaffee? Oh, I guess you can have this badge. Arnold Roth, my first encounter with Arnold Roth actually goes back much farther than Al Jaffee. I was a mad reader since I was a kid. I remember my reading that, being amazed, Al, at that first fold-in of the Beatles that was a diagonal fold-in, and suddenly they went from being the Beatles to being bald Beatles. But Arnold Roth, I remember, as being very, very young. And my parents, my father was a Louis Armstrong fan, and I'm glad that I inherited that gene. But he also had some cooler jazz records, too. And he had a record of Dave Brubeck with this endless keyboard. And I can remember sitting on the couch, I might have been 5 years old, and looking at this beautiful, elegant drawing of Dave Brubeck at the keyboard. And there in the corner was the signature Arnold Roth. I was just learning how to read, and I could read that signature. So the reason why these fellas are here today is because the Wise People Fan Graphics, I can plug this book because I'm not like a publisher of the company or anything, but they put together this double volume set of the complete humbug. This is Hum and this is Bug. And we're going to talk today a little bit about how this magazine came out. This is a comics crowd. I can tell you're already fairly savvy about what this book represents and what Humbug was. But for those of you who are not, very briefly, the mastermind behind Humbug was a fellow named Harvey Kurtzman, who I was fortunate enough to have as a teacher for about 5 minutes at an SBA. And he was coming from several earlier humor magazines. Everyone's like, Paul, I know this story. Okay, just bear with me for those of you in the audience who do not know this story. Harvey Kurtzman is the genius behind the creation of Mad Magazine, which of course was first the Mad Comic book. And after a run at Mad, he severed ties with DC Comics, and he went over to Playboy and produced two issues of a magazine called Trump. And then that fell apart. And then he was started this remarkable run of Humbug, which was a small format humor magazine. And it's appropriate, I think, that we're talking about Humbug today in this venue, where there's so many people, there's young people who are self-publishing. Because these fellows were, Humbug was basically a communal publishing enterprise, almost unheard of in the history of magazines. And each one of you had a share of the magazine, is that right? How did that work?
Yes, well, should I?
Diving.
He'll give a completely different answer, I think. We all became partners in Humbug, equal partners, actually, except for Jack Day. One thing I should tell you, who was involved. I never worked for Mad. I think I was the only one who did it. Yeah. And Harvey Kurtzman, of course, had invented Mad. We had Willie Elder, now dead, Harvey's dead. Jack Davis is still alive, but lives lives in Georgia, which is the same. it was that way before he came up. He brought it with him. And, and then it was Al, and there was me, Arnold. So I had joined them at Trump. I had never been in comic books. And I was a few years younger than everyone else, I think.
You still are.
Yes. Well, once you learn how to do it. But what we did was to put money in to fund the magazine. Jack Davis did not put money in, and as a matter of fact, we paid him. It was a minimal amount during the whole thing. And, but we, you know, we were desperate to have him. So whatever it had to be, we had to grin and bear it. And there's no rancor about it, but actually he was the smartest one in the bunch, as it turned out. And eventually, I could jump around in the story, but I won't go to the end, but eventually we needed a little more capital. And as a matter of fact, I borrowed money from Rubeck and Paul Besman and Sal and Max Weiss, who owned Fantasy Records. And I did a lot of album covers for them in the 50s, the 60s. And so I ended up owning the title because of that additional investment. Right after we failed, the magazine failed,